Hello everyone, I welcome you all to the course Radar Engineering. This is the second lecture of Module 5, the Radar Antennas. In the previous lecture, we have started with the radar antenna functions and also further discussed about some of the various performance parameters of the antenna in context to the radar applications. Today we are going to talk about a very important antenna for radar application is reflector antennas, and I am going to take some 3 to 4 lectures on reflector antennas, and this is a part 1 of the reflector antennas. Today we are going to talk about what is reflector antennas, what are the different configurations that we have in reflector antennas. Mostly when we talk about a radar applications, the very popular configuration of the reflector antenna is a parabolic reflector antenna, and we are going to see the properties of the parabolic reflector antenna, design aspects of the parabolic reflector antenna, various versions of the parabolic reflector surfaces and their applications, and finally we will look upon the design challenges in the reflector antenna modeling followed by references. What is reflector antenna? A quick introduction I would like to take upon this. The reflector antenna is an aperture type antenna, we all know that, where the physical size of the antenna is the major concern, because in the microwave applications, especially for radar applications, we require very high gain antennas to cover a larger range and to establish a long range radio communication. We require a high gain antennas, and these type of antennas, specifically reflector antennas, will fulfill the requirement of providing high gain. Therefore, the reflector antennas are most widely used type of an antenna for high gain applications and routinely achieve gains in the order of 30 dB in the microwave region. If I take a conventional one element microstrip patch antenna, hardly it can able to give a maximum gain of 7 dB, 8 dB. But if you take a reflector antenna, it is capable of producing a gain of approximately 30 dB in microwave region. So huge amount of gain can be provided, can be achieved from these aperture antennas. Okay, there are different types of aperture antennas, RN antennas are examples for aperture type antenna, reflector antennas, parabolic dish. There are number of antennas which are under the category of the aperture type. Today we are interested on reflector antennas. And if I take the geometry of the reflector antenna as a whole, it consists of two components. One is the reflecting surface, okay, and it should be large enough relative to the wavelength of the transmitted signal, and the second component is the feed antenna. And compared to the reflector surface, reflecting surface, the feed antenna should be much smaller. So it has two components, one is a reflecting surface and the second one is the feed antenna. Okay, and how to choose the reflecting surface and which configuration is suitable for what applications, and how to select the feed antenna, the type of the feed antenna, and where to place this feed antenna. There are number of questions. Okay, to answer these questions, we need to understand the first the basic principles of reflector antenna. Okay, there are some properties. This is the most popular form of the reflector antenna, and it is parabolic reflector antenna. The reflecting surface is parabolic in nature. Okay, this is a parabolic surface, and this is a vertex or the apex of the parabolic surface. At the focus, we have placed the feed. Okay, so what are the two properties? Mainly, this parabolic surface is well suited for microwave antennas, because any ray from the focus which is reflected in the direction of the in the direction parallel to the axis of the parabola, this is the axis of the parabola, any ray from the focus is reflected in a direction parallel to the axis of the parabola. Any ray you can take, this ray or this ray, any ray you can take, when it hits the parabolic surface, it will be reflected back towards the plane of the parabola, and the distance traveled by any ray from the focus onto the parabolic surface and by reflection to a plane which is perpendicular to the parabolic axis. This is the parabolic axis, and this is the plane perpendicular to the parabolic axis, is independent of its path. That means all the rays leaving the focal point, okay, any ray you can take, the rays leaving the focal point are collimated after reflection from the reflector, and the reflected rays are perpendicular to the reflector axis. Okay, and all the path lengths from the focal point to the reflector and on to the aperture plane, this is the aperture plane, are same and are equals to 2f. Okay, and this f is the focal length of the reflector antenna. Okay, from the apex to the aperture plane is f, and all the path length if you calculate from the focal point to the reflector and from the reflector surface to the aperture plane are equals to 2f. This total length is equals to 2f. These are the two properties of the parabolic reflector. Okay, and here this feed is acts like a primary antenna, and it is placed at the focus, and it will generate a feed pattern. Okay, we have a secondary radiator. Your parabolic surface acts like a secondary antenna or the secondary radiator or a reflector, because it will reflect the rays which are illuminated by the feed. This is a basic property of this parabolic reflector. Okay, this is the primary antenna and this is a secondary antenna. And how to shape the secondary beam after the reflection from the parabolic surface is a big challenge. Design aspects of parabolic reflector antenna. If I take the simple geometry of the parabolic reflector, okay, so I have considered a ray which is originated from the feed which is placed at the focus, onto the surface of the parabola. Okay, this length is denoted by R dash. Okay, and this is the reflected ray from the parabolic surface onto the aperture plane. Okay, perpendicular to the axis of the parabola. So this is the length PQ and this is the length R dash, and it is equals to OP. This is the point P. If you take this point P in the three dimensional plane, x dash comma y dash comma z dash, okay, and this is the vertical dimension OQ. Okay, also conveniently I have taken the length from O to the edge of the parabolic surface. Okay, there is an angle formed due to this length from the feed focal point to the surface edge. Okay, this is theta naught and this is theta dash. Okay, you all know that for the parabola, the length OP, OP plus PQ, which is constant and it is equal to 2F from the property of the parabola. Because we know that all the path length from the focal point to the reflector and from the reflector onto the aperture plane are same and it is equal to 2F. Okay. F plus F, it is equal to 2F. OP plus PQ, this is equal to 2F. And we know that OP equals to R dash and PQ equals to R dash into cos theta dash. Cos theta dash. And this vertical dimension is given by R dash into sin theta dash. Okay, it is not interested. Okay. To calculate, what must be the R dash equation in terms of the angle theta dash and the focal length F? Okay, this is the diameter of the parabola, this is D. Okay, if I add this length OP plus PQ, we have R dash plus PQ is R dash into cos theta dash. If I take R dash common, we get R dash into 1 plus cos theta dash. It is equal to 2F, we know that. Rearrange the equation and get the equation for R dash. R dash must be 2F divided by 1 plus cos theta dash. Okay. Alternatively, we can write the equation for R dash as F into secant square of theta dash by 2. When the angle theta is very, very less than and equals to theta naught, okay, the R dash plus R dash cos theta dash is equals to square root of x dash square plus y dash square plus z dash square plus z dash equals to 2f. We know that this is equals to 2f and we have the expression for R dash. This is equal to 2F by 1 plus cos theta dash divided by equals to F into secant square of theta dash by 2. Okay, this is from the basic parabola equation from the property. Okay, at the apex. Okay, at the apex, what is the value of R dash? At the apex, theta dash equals to 0. Okay, at the apex or the vertex, the theta dash equals to 0. When theta dash equals to 0, that means we get R dash equals to F, because cos theta dash is 1 plus 1 2 2f by 2 is F. R dash becomes R dash becomes F when you are at the apex. Theta dash equals to 0 degree. And what is OQ? And there won't be any value for OQ because we are at the apex of the vertex, the parabola. Because this is equal to R dash into sine theta dash. Okay, theta dash equals to 0 degree, sine 0 is 0, so there won't be this length. Okay, and what is the value of R dash at the reflector edge? When theta dash equals to theta naught, the R dash is given by 2f divided by 1 plus cos theta naught. Okay, the theta dash is replaced by theta naught. And OQ becomes D by 2. Okay, there are two very important parameters when you go for the design of a parabolic reflector. To completely specify the design, we have these two parameters. One is the diameter of the reflector, and one more is the focal length F. Okay, usually the reflector design will be completed when you state these two parameters. One is the diameter and other one is F bar D ratio, where F bar D ratio is very, very important. Focal length to the diameter ratio, F bar D ratio. Usually the F bar D ratio to be larger so that some of the losses can be reduced. A spillover can be reduced when you take F bar D ratio as higher. The feed length should be larger enough so that you can reduce some of the effects. Okay, we are going to see what is the impact on the reflector antenna performance when you take a larger value of F bar D. Okay, basically this diameter will be talking about the size of the reflector. Okay, and this F bar D will shape the reflector surface, the curvature rate, at what rate this reflector curvature is taken. The shape of the curvature is decided upon the value of F bar D, and the size of the reflector surface is based on the value of D. Okay, these are the two very important parameters to completely specify the reflector design. Okay, these two equations are very, very important. One is F bar D ratio, okay, where theta naught, okay, is given by tan inverse of D by 2 by Z naught, where Z naught is this value, okay, from the edge to the aperture plane. Okay, this is Z naught, this length is Z naught. Theta naught is equal to tan inverse of, if you solve the equation for theta naught, we get tan inverse of D by 2 by Z naught. Okay. Or alternatively, we can write the equation for theta naught in terms of F bar D ratio by rearranging this. Okay. Tan inverse of 1 by 4 into F bar D. Okay. We know that F bar D is equal to 1 by 4 tan of theta naught by 2, or F equals to D by 4 cot of theta naught by 2. Okay, 1 by tan is nothing but a cot. Okay, alternatively this expression can be used. Okay, if you take the value of theta naught, or you can calculate F bar D. For a given values of F bar D, you can calculate theta naught. Okay, the F bar D value is varied from 0.4 to 1. Okay, the theta naught value is calculated in this way. what is the impact on this theta naught value, okay, when you vary the value of f bar d, or for different values of theta naught, what is the value of f bar d? Okay, as the value of f bar d increases, the theta naught value is reducing. Okay, in the next coming lecture, we are going to talk about the impact of these parameters. Okay, when we discuss a feeds for reflector antenna and their feed support, we will talk about the selection of f bar d and theta naught values, where we are going to discuss which value is desirable for the reflector antennas. Okay, the versions of the parabolic reflector surfaces. Okay, the parabolic reflector, the basic parabolic reflector surface or the contour has been used in variety of configurations. Okay, one which is circular parabola or paraboloid, it is called as a paraboloid. Okay, how to obtain this configuration? By rotating the parabolic curve about its axis, or by revolving the parabolic curve about its axis, we get this configuration, and this is called circular parabola or paraboloid. Why to take this configuration? And this configuration of the parabolic reflecting surface will produce a symmetrical pencil beam pattern, and it will be useful in the tracking radars to track the targets. Okay, it will produce a symmetrical pencil beam pattern, and this will be useful in tracking radars. Okay, in some applications only part of the paraboloid is used to produce either asymmetrical or symmetrical beam pattern. Asymmetrical beam shape can be obtained. If you want asymmetrical beam shape, example a fan beam. In some applications, if a fan beams are desired, then we can only take a part of the paraboloid, by which we can obtain asymmetrical beam shape. Okay, and there is a other version also, that is parabolic cylinder. Okay, by moving the parabolic contour parallel to itself, we are able to get either symmetrical or asymmetrical beam patterns. Okay, that is nothing but a shaped beams. The shaped beams can be produced by taking the parabolic cylinder as the configuration for the reflector surface. And this parabolic cylinder is fed with a line source rather than point source. Example, a linear array is used to feed the parabolic cylinder. Okay, there are different varieties of parabolic surfaces, the variations of the parabolic reflectors, such as parabolic torus, cheeses, pillboxes, hoghorns. These variations can be found in any of the literature of the reflector antennas. These are the different types of radar beams, as we have seen. By taking the varieties of reflector configurations, we are able to produce different types of antenna beams. Okay, this is a one structure, this is a one, it is producing a pencil beam, and this is a one type of a structure, a reflector structure, and this is producing fan beam. Similarly, this is going to produce a stacked beam, and a shaped beam can be produced by this particular reflector antenna. And these pictures are taken from MIT Lincoln Lab, US, with permission. Okay, what is the effect of the aperture size on gain? If you increase the size of the aperture, what is the impact on gain? We all know that the aperture area is proportional to gain. As you increase the size of the aperture, we are able to get a more gain. So this is a plot. Okay, put aperture diameter with respect to maximum gain. As you increase the diameter of the reflector antenna, we are able to achieve a maximum gain. Okay, so different wavelengths are considered at different frequencies, 3 gigahertz, 1 gigahertz, 300 megahertz. Okay, for different frequencies, people have done some investigation, and from this there is a clear evidence, okay, showing that as the aperture diameter increases, the gain increases. The gain increases as the aperture becomes electrically larger. The diameter is a larger number of wavelengths, okay, from this relation. Effect of aperture size on the beam width. We know that gain and effective aperture or the physical aperture, okay, it is inversely proportional to beam width. Okay, as the aperture becomes electrically larger and larger, the beam width decreases. Okay, similarly, some plot is considered. In the x-axis we have taken aperture diameter, in the y-axis we have taken half power beam width. As you increase the aperture diameter, we are able to achieve a lesser the value of half power beam width, because it is inversely proportional to half power beam width. What are the design challenges? Okay, till now we have seen the importance of the reflector antenna, different versions of the reflector antenna surfaces, the design issues in the reflector antenna design. Okay, so now you can raise these questions in order to understand the significance of the reflector antenna in the context of the radar applications. Okay, the very first question: how to model the reflector surface? What should be the value of f bar d? What should be the value of theta naught? How to model it? And how to choose the feed? What should be the focal length? What should be the feed length? And what type of feed is suitable for particular application? And when feed is selected, how to support it with the mechanical support? And it is very challenging how to shape the secondary pattern from the illumination of the feed. As we have seen, different beam shapes, okay, are produced by the reflector surfaces: pencil beam, fan beam, stacked beam, shaped beam. How to produce effectively? There are challenges. And how to reduce the spillover? This is a loss. Okay, and how to reduce the blockage? How to increase the aperture efficiency? How to increase the gain? If I start writing the questions on the design of the reflector antenna and about the challenges, there are number of questions. In order to answer these questions, We are going to discuss, we have to discuss different types of feeds which are normally used for reflector antennas, okay, from the literature, and we should discuss which feed antenna is suitable for what applications. And what are the supporting configurations that are suggested to place the feed, okay, and how to increase the gain, okay. If gain is specified, it is associated with the loss, right? So how to control the losses of the antenna system, and how to increase the aperture efficiency. So there are number of issues. In the next lecture, we will talk about the extension of the reflector antennas in the part 2. These are the references. So this is a usual reference which is prescribed in the syllabus, Introduction to the Radar Systems by Merrill I. Skolnick, 3rd edition test book, okay. And this is the PPT, like guest lecture PPT, by Dr. Robert M. O'Donnell, okay, the titled Radar Systems Engineering Lecture 8, Antennas Part 1, Basics of Antennas and Mechanical Scanning. And additionally, have also referred a lecture PPT delivered by Professor Girish Kumar, IIT Bombay, okay, from NPTEL online course, Antennas. Okay, these are some of the references which I took for my presentation. In the next part, we are going to see the different types of feeds for reflector antennas. Thank you.